So why are we here? So why is analytics important for the process industries? And there's some fundamental things that we think have shifted in the market. So as an analyst, we get exposed to a lot of different oil and gas companies and chemical industries. So we learn about some of your challenges, and we talk to a lot of folks that are making some really cool technology. Last year, when we started studying machine learning and predictive analytics, the number of suppliers that have emerged were in the thousands. Okay, so there's a lot of dynamics that are happening today, but basically what we're finding is it's getting easier and easier to collect data. An example that I have here on the slide is a bearing from, or a bearing monitor from SKF that's got some built-in technologies, and the technologies are getting so small and compact and easy to configure with your systems that you don't need much of the complexity of the systems of yesterday. And we know ultimately that certain industries, especially the aviation industry, has done a great job of making it, changing the way that we do maintenance in that particular industry. So in this case, I've got this would be a GE turbine, and we understand a little bit about how they do the maintenance and collect information. So one of the most important connected assets we know is actually one that's up in the sky. So what we see is happening is because it's easy to collect data and it's getting much simpler, we've seen the emergence of something called IoT or analytics platform. So this is the way that ARC would present this, and we understand that many companies are building very unique ways to ingest many different data sources. And the data sources that I think of in the process industries are the things like all of your historian archives. It could be your operator logs. It could be your incident management system. It could be data relative to the operator training and things that are happening. So a lot of this data is getting easier and easier with new platforms to ingest this data. So what we see ultimately, and because we know that data in the process is very, very, it's very unclean, and much of the data is erroneous. So we know that many of the suppliers and the solutions are really good at cleansing the data and bringing this into systems that owner operators and users can easily make sense of the data. But before I get going, I want to talk about. This is a movie that I saw recently. How many people have seen 2001, A Space Odyssey? Excellent, okay, that's right. This is really good, because this is sort of fundamental to my talk here. But I want to introduce the persona on the left here is Dave Bowman. Okay, so in Stanley Kubrick's movie, The Space Odyssey, so he was the astronaut. He was kind of the guy in charge, and he was a subject matter expert, and he's kind of like today's operator or tomorrow's operator. And on the right-hand side, you have this thing called HAL. And HAL in the movie was a autonomous computer capable of natural language recognition and could interact with the astronauts in space. So I think what's happened here is that Stanley Kubrick in Hollywood back in 1968, they actually came up with something very profound about the way maintenance and operations should be carried out. So I'm going to play a little clip of a video, and then I'm going to talk about some of the things that we see industry relative to that clip. So just bear with me. This is only 1 minute in length. And I think we need some sound. So basically what's happening here is the computer has identified a fault with a very critical piece of equipment on the spacecraft called the AE-35 unit. So there's a dialogue that's taking place right now between a computer and a human is interpreting what's happening. And since we don't have any sound, I don't think we're going to get it. I'm just going to flip to the dialogue here. So basically what happens is HAL basically says, you know, I've got a fault. Okay, but what really happened, right? So the artificial intelligence or the analytics basically identifies a problem and probably wasn't a threshold monitoring, so it wasn't a condition-based monitoring thing. So basically the computer we know is looking at multivariate data and machine learning, so not a threshold alert, right? So the human says, or the subject matter expert, is it still within operating limits? And basically he wants to understand, I'm operating this craft, could be a facility, what is my risk? Is there something I can do to change my operation? So Computer has identified fault. Immediately, human doesn't immediately react. The human actually does a little bit more interrogation. But further, what happens is the AI, HAL 9000 in this case, says, yes, so we confirm that we're within operational limits, and HAL basically says, yes, it'll stay that way until it fails. Right, so there's further interrogation of the information that's on board with additional on-premise information. But one of the key points here that Stanley Kubrick brings forward is the human says, do I have a reliable 72 hours? So this is not an immediate failure, because of course you wouldn't want to have an immediate failure on a system. There's an exchange between human and computer to quantify or a probability of failure on this piece of equipment. So this is the most important aspect of analytics that I'm going to talk about in this presentation, because we're dealing with probabilities and lots of data, not on single threshold where it's too late and the AE35 unit has gone offline. So the next thing that happens is, once now that we've had this exchange, there's a new work process that gets implemented on this spacecraft. And this work process is not a replacement work process that you might have with an EAM system or a CMMS process or something that would invoke maintenance. In this case, the subject matter expert, the astronaut, says, I'm going to enact a performance analysis process, and I'm going to do a little bit of digging to see if there's something I can change in the way I'm running this ship to keep this thing from failing. So the AE35 unit just happens to be the main communication back to central control. So all this dialogue happens in about a couple of hours in movie time, and there's an analysis and looking at models, and ultimately they decide that there's nothing they can change with the operation. It's time to fix the piece of equipment. So that's the video that you didn't get to see. So why do I think that's important? Because I think that's important because, at least in this industry, historically, most of the maintenance and most of the cost has been spent on break-fix maintenance. So we would see, this is our ARC's maturity model for asset performance management, and we would say that, I would say my guess as an analyst is probably closer 1-2% of all maintenance has been predicted with the tools they have. So what happens is there's new tools, new platforms, new sensors that are allowing companies to take advantage of analytics. So if you look at the sort of the bottom from the condition-based down, the threshold-based monitoring technologies, you know, they've been around for a while. They work, they have the valid purpose. But what we're seeing is that the analytics is applicable to the top two, which would be the predictive, the PDM, and the prescriptive. Because ultimately, we see that the solutions as being a lot more sophisticated, and not only can they diagnose root cause, but they can actually provide prescriptive advice on how to change the outcome. So this might be a little bit different from some of the things that you're seeing in the industry today. So, looking at it from another perspective, we think that operationally in the process industries, what we're doing here is we're trying to predict failure points. So when I think about assets in the process industries, I'm thinking about exchangers, batch processes, reactors, this could be centrifugal pumps, axial compressors, all these things that are critical to the process that tend to be operated and maintained in separate silos in a very reactive manner. So what analytics we see doing is if you look at the asset performance curve, what we're seeing is that companies who are successful in using this are not waiting for actual process degradation or operational failures and suffering downtime in their facilities. They're actually using the tools and empowering the workers with these processes that I described as process improvement workflows to actually do more detection earlier. So some of the clients might be looking at detection of, say, 90 days or 6 months in advance. So the companies are using the right data to actually look at the triggers that are happening actually weeks and months in advance, and possibly changing the operation and preventing the actual degradation from occurring. So basically, we look at everything on the right-hand side. This is all condition-based monitoring. Everything on the left is analytics. These are some other statistics that have been floated around for a long time. UAL, the US Navy, they've done lots of great studies. But one of the things we see when we look at assets is most of the data is based on perfect conditions done in the lab, and they're actually done and they're not the testing is not done in actually the way that they're operated. So we find that because operations is sometimes there's a lot of variability, the process flows can vary quite a bit. Sometimes the assets don't actually perform as expected. So basically, these studies have said that over 80% of all the failures tend to be random. So fast forward and looking at analytics, go back one, sorry. The question is what's really causing those random failures? So the companies that have embarked on these pilots and programs, they're finding markers, to going back to that performance curve, they're actually detecting when the assets will fail in advance. And they're not just looking at the information that comes off the rotating equipment or the discrete device. They're actually looking at the data that's around it. So some people talk about big data or tiny data. There are aspects of analytics to look more holistically at the things that impact the assets. I had the opportunity to meet with Martin Hawkins. He's the COO of HMEL. They're a refiner based in Southeast Asia. And this is just an example of some of the financial benefits that they see in their strategy. By the way, this conference was last October. It was all about analytics. So everybody in that region they feel as though their organizations are ready. Everybody was talking about this technology. So basically, it's maintenance budgets, it's operations budget, it's increasing availability. But ultimately, he looked at this from two sides. One, reducing total operations and maintenance costs, and also improving operations performance. Sometimes I speak about industrial Internet of Things and analytics, and there's a tendency to think that we've been doing this for many, many years. What's new? We've been connecting devices. But actually, what we find is when we talk to customers is that most of this data has already been collected and has been sitting dormant within the various disparate systems, whether it's a process historian. And there's a lot of effort goes, of course, to mining that data, applying that context by people that understand the process of the assets to make determination. So what we see is we would say that this is an application of machine learning. So the people that are spending all of the time contextualizing this data, the machine learning and the analytics is actually automating that to produce the results they need and the outcomes for their particular industry. So another question that we often get is about the engineers and about the staff and the erosion of the workforce. So your engineers that understand this context and they know which tags and which trend and they know what happened the last time they overpressured a vessel or the last time they did flaring, there's people that understand all of that. So companies are starting to look at how to capture that data and the things that they did naturally with historian data and other systems and the workflows that were built in, it's capturing that information and making it available in systems for the next generation of workers that coming in. Because most clients that we talk to, erosion of workforce is definitely a serious issue. This is yesterday's technology. We've had great dashboards and they've worked very well. But you know, I think most customers would say that they've had difficulties getting access to the data, and it's been very, very difficult. A lot of these systems are maintained by IT shops, and they don't have context, and they're not in enough time. So this is where we've been with the technology. Those of you that may have attended our workshop on analytic selection yesterday, Mike Guilfoyle presented this. So this is the way that we would see the market. And we're not saying you don't want to do everything prescriptive or you don't want to predict everything, but there are certain assets that you will turn to predictive strategies. But there's also assets that you will do break fix, and certainly dashboards and what we call performance analytics would be adequate. So on the left-hand side, the category of suppliers are more threshold-based and based on performance. Basically, we would say that those are important for decisions that are reactive. Usually, there's some damage done, but you're averting a crisis. But if we look to the newer breed of technologies with analytics and machine learning, this is more like what is likely to happen. It's dealing with structured and unstructured data. There's sandbox environments, so folks can do their own development and look for problems that they didn't know that they had. But what they're trying to do ultimately is avoid the damage and avoid the crisis. So this is about further reducing cost. And most of the suppliers that we see that are doing interesting things with machine learning and then technologies are more on the predictive side. It's still a little bit new on the prescriptive side, and it's definitely most of the solutions are not closed loop. They're informing a human. So just as Stanley Kubrick depicted, the computer is detecting the problem and informing the subject matter expert, so the subject matter expert can remedy the activity. So this is we know that there are different types of machine learning in predictive and prescriptive analytics. This is a bit related to data mining. This is there's supervised and unsupervised, and there's also deep learning is another form of machine learning. The other interesting dynamic in the question that we get asked, because with complexity of data and new platforms and new systems, is how are we going to ready our workforce? So some of the folks that are behind the scenes, you know, you often hear about data science scientists. So this is how we would see a data scientist, and they're not prevalent, they're not common in industry, and they're certainly not common in oil and gas or other process industries. But they may be curious about data, like your engineers, but they're trained with a particular set of tools that your process engineers tend to not get trained on. So most engineers use simulation tools. They use Excel, XY plots, some statistical and some basic modeling tools. But most engineers in the process are not trained on things like statistical computing, MapReduce concepts, distributed computing. So these are all skills that come along with this data scientist. So we would see, as we move forward with predictive analytics or prescriptive analytics, the data scientist has got to be part of the solution in some way. So that's either with the technology supplier or it's built into the solution to make it easy, because we don't see every oil and gas or chemical company is going to start hiring a bunch of data scientists to do the work. And in terms of opportunities for predictive analytics or machine learning, you know, the sky's the limit. There's so many clients that we talk to that are doing proof of concepts in different areas, and it's not just about preventing machines from breaking down, like machines that spin. It's detecting when incidents or looking for the markers that can detect when you're going to flood columns, or whether you might cause a process upset or something like that. Because oftentimes the process, the way the processes work is sometimes it's not on off. Sometimes the process is just degraded because of a problem. It could be foaming or fouling of different systems. So it's looking for those things using the tools that you didn't have before. So it could be process quality. It could be on the back end, on the things that face the customer, and ultimately dealing with process variability. So there's some really important things, and as we continue to research the subject, we find many, many cases where customers are finding evidence of benefits with predictive analytics. And that's just, if you want more information, those of you that follow our blogs, industrial-iot.com is one source where we're continually writing case studies or putting information out. Or just go to arcweb.com, manufacturing operation technology, and this is all available on your mobile device. So I encourage you all to go to these sites to continue to follow what we're writing about analytics. So what I'd like to do at this time is Dr. Satyam Priyadarsha. He's technical fellow and chief data scientist with Halliburton. So he's going to give a talk about predictive analytics as he sees in his industry. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Priyadarsha.
Good afternoon. I heard Peter talked about big data, machine learning, all in one breath. So I guess all of you have now heard what big data means. How many do you know what big data is? All right, there's some people, so good. So hopefully I'll help you understand a little bit about that and how it's actually applicable to the oil and gas industry, but across many other industries as well. Especially when we are talking about how do we increase the value of the process. And if you know, oil and gas industry is one of the most complex industry in terms of processes. And as we all know, they're very inefficient processes across, because we don't know the hidden inefficiencies in the process. So roughly that's the agenda. I'll talk about what's the commonality between the oil and gas industry and manufacturing process. How do we define big data? Because it's a term which I think, depending on which magazine you read, it defines it differently. I'll define it differently from them, but I think that comes from my 15 years of experience in that field. And then I'll talk about what emerging technologies are needed and how do we actually create value, and then give you one or two examples of how we are actually using it. So before I do that, I have to actually tell you a story. This is a story how, when you know how to recognize patterns, which is unusual, it can actually give birth to industry. And this is the true story of India's oil and gas industry. In 1800, in eastern part of India, a Canadian engineer looks at an elephant and it says it is wet, but it is not wet like water. Because if you know, in eastern part of India, it rains all the time and elephants are gray in color. So to differentiate that wetness, which is not by water, he says, what is it? So he asks the local people, where are you coming from? And then they take him to the middle of the jungle and say the oil was actually coming out. And it's been coming out for quite some time. So he gets people and says, Dig Boy, Dig Boy. That is a city in India called Dig Boy. It is headquarter for India's second largest oil company called Oil India Limited, right? Of course, I know enough about the industry because I grew up on the other one, which is ONGC, India's largest oil company, and I happen to have learned a lot from it. So elephants are a big picture, animals. So you see just a subtle difference on such a body that changed an industry. And this is what we are looking from when we talk about big data analytics. So if you look at the commonality between oil and gas industry, it is a very simple thing. It's the materials, right? The machines, the methods, measurements, and then modeling. It is exactly common everywhere. Every piece of this process cycle is important for us. So is for manufacturing, so is for any other places. So if we know how to optimize these things, we can actually change the industry and create more economic value. Why? How can we create economic value? Is the, actually, Peter was showing you the chart about prescriptive and predictive analytics. If you see this chart, it's a cartoon diagram, but it has a lot of meaning on it. Most of the industry does is collect the data. That's a lot of data, and that's in red. Right, if you talk to oil and gas people and other industry, they will say, oh, we know how to handle big data because we have collected a lot of data. But collecting data is not a problem. It is actually a very big problem because you can't create value. And of course, we collect data in silos. Within an organization, within a company, within an organization, you can actually have multiple copies of the data. And if you actually try to synthesize them, you will not get the same results. So there is that silo problem exists, whether it is sales, whether it's supply chain, whether it's equipment failure, everywhere we have these challenges. If you look at oil and gas industry, it's a one process. You find the oil, you drill, and you produce, right? But we look at them in different silos: exploration, drilling, completion, production, and things like that. So that happens in many other industry. The goal is that we have to move to this portion. This is where industry spends most of its time in KPIs and dashboard. They're all outdated things, right? Then we have now started talking about predictive analytics. Then we talk about prescriptive analytics. What I talk about is holistic analytics, which is big data analytics. If you look at the slope of this curve, this is significant change in economic value, right? Because it is a continuous improvement process. It is not a one-time. KPIs and dashboard are typically one-time process because whoever is the executive, he wants to look at certain numbers. That's all the dashboard is created. And within a company, we have thousands and thousands of dashboards. Right, I can give you examples from many of the Fortune 100 companies that I've consulted for before. But the thing is, that doesn't give you value because you're not generating any actionable insight. So if your organization on the analytics maturity curve, where is it? Most companies will fall in this area. Very few companies go here because this is a continuous improvement process. If you just look at a mathematical complexity, and I think Peter put a nice slide of a data scientist in all, like so many things one has to know, it's a complex thing. But if you want to do the holistic analytics, you really need to understand the cognitive computing side as well. And if you think what cognitive computing, have you heard the word, right, cognitive computing? That's all of us sitting here, the brain power, which is very cognitive. We can see things that computers can't see yet, right? If you look at your digital camera, you can take a picture, it does a face recognition, but it draws a rectangle over a face. Maybe one, two, three faces, no more than that. But when we are driving at 80 miles per hour on Texas highway, you can actually analyze everything that comes in front of you in a fraction of a second. You will know it's a bird, it's a flower, it's a road, it's a car, it's everything. So that much of the power is needed. That is what is called cognitive computing. We are not, no one is right there. So any industrial process, whether it's oil and gas or any other industry, to build cognitive computing power, that means we have to put all our tacit knowledge into it before we can actually build something. Right? So this is how we define big data. Right, 6 blind people were asked to describe an elephant, and each one will describe elephant based on the body part they touch. And this is a story from 300 BC from India in a book called Panchtantra. And this is how they describe it. Snake, spear, fan, log, drum, and brush. This is exactly how we actually define big data. The easiest definition we talk is it's lots of data, right? Then there are a lot of people who will say, let's go build a data lake. Then, of course, the technical definition is volume, velocity, 3 Vs or 4 Vs that people talk about. There's a lot of literature around it. If nothing else, we'll say, let's collect more and more data. Then you talk to the Silicon Valleys of the world, and they will tell you it's about Hadoop and Storm and Kafka and whatnot technologies that they actually do. And you just heard Peter mention a little bit earlier about machine learning and neural networks and artificial intelligence and deep learning, correct? Or if you don't understand, then you can say it's a buzzword, right? So this is how we are all blind people, basically, in some sense, because we are actually trying to describe an elephant in from various parts that we know. So technology people will talk about these kind of things. BI people will talk about this. And the people who store the data, they call about lots of data. So we have to bring an organization together. So all these definitions are wrong, right? What it is actually is about all the data. That means, what is all the data means? That means the historical data that we have collected, the current data that we are generating, and the future data that we don't know. Especially in oil and gas industry, if you think of it, we are going to deploy IoT sensors. There are not going to be any standardization of how the data will come. Are we ready to actually tame that data or not? Right? And that's very important to plan for it. That means we have to use the concept called data pipelining, and be ready for any kind of data. That means the data can be anywhere. It has to be on the field. It can be in my office, on my computer, in a data warehouse. As long as I can connect the data to create insights, that is what is important. That means we have to become an expert on using new technologies and leverage the full analytics value chain. It's not about just doing statistical models, not about just physics formulas, not about neural networks, not about machine learning. It's a complete value chain that you have to use for creating the insights so that you can actually grow your business by finding the hidden inefficiencies. That is what is big data all about. If I simplify this definition, this is the definition that one can remember. It's about creating the value from all the data by leveraging emerging technologies, right? To create actionable insights by finding the hidden inefficiencies. Because if it is not hidden, then you already know them. You must have fixed them. These are the things that you are trying to improve, right? And so that you can actually grow your business through continuous data-driven environment, right? That requires three things which are very important. First one is the paradigm shift of thinking. It's not about asking, you have the question, you're looking for the answer. Question is same for everybody. How can I improve my business? Beyond that, you have to go. If you look in the data patterns and then find out. That means look at that, in analogy-wise, look at that foot of the elephant with the oil wet. Can I differentiate or not? So look at the data, the new patterns that have been generated from the data by connecting the data. That is what you're looking for. So you have to become good at pattern recognition. If you can't do it, that's where the technology exists. But of course, we have to always keep the stakeholder value in the process because we are all businesses. We're not doing academic exercise here, right? So this is the definition of big data that I work with. How do we leverage it? Just to give you an example from oil and gas industry, it's a complex industry. Look at it, upstream, midstream, downstream, exploration, production. It's like literally petabytes of data. In exploration, we can generate roughly for 1 square kilometer, roughly about 5 petabytes of data. Right? You have to make sense out of it. It's just as it's an acoustic signal data, basically. And trying to build a three-dimensional view of the subsurface, as that means under the earth, that you cannot see. Right? But throughout the life cycle, you have enormous amount of different kinds of data. And in order to make sense, it's an open challenge. So even if you look at just the upstream section, it's complex. Nobody can combine the downstream is actually much easier because that's where we go and buy the gas. That's why you get all these coupons from Shell and other companies that you partner with a grocery store, you get a loyalty coupon. So that works in a traditional retail big data analytics framework, right? But when it comes to actually optimizing upstream and midstream, is actually very complex. So how do we do that? The concept is building a single integrated platform, right? Which is agile and modular. We are not dependent. This is the information layer. We can connect to any data source. It doesn't matter what it is. SQL, NoSQL, file, Hadoop, whatever you name it. We will connect it, and if a new technology comes tomorrow, we can connect it. The concept is what we call it is a decision space integration server. That's our platform brand name, but let's talk about integration server, which talks to any technology that comes. If it's somebody's proprietary database, we can have a database source, as I call it, we can actually build plugin. And then we allow you to integrate that data so that you have the right context, whether it is the drilling, whether it's the drilling data, whether it's a production data, or whether it's a reservoir data, it's like different languages that they speak, but they have to still talk to the same place. So we can build that integration in it, and then you build the applications needed as shown here. And the goal is to build these apps, so to say, for what purpose it is. Is it for equipment failure? Is it for the field? And things like that. So one, and this is a scalable system. Your all algorithms, you want to call it physics formulas, engineering formulas, they all sit in this space. And you can expand it to as much as you want. For our, just to give you an example, in the geoscience domain, we roughly have about 800 different algorithms that are taken, that are being run to actually create some value out of the data. This is how we think about how the world changes with big data analytics. That means we can keep track of the content, we build the connection, we leverage any technology like cloud, and then we build customized application. That's how we address the problem in any of the industry, right? We can have a long discussion about cloud security and all, but let's assume that security exists, then this is one of the best way to scale any of your analytics things for any industry. So how do we do that? So question is like, give you some examples how we leverage this. So before I do that, here is a question for you. What do you see here? That's the same data all of you are looking at.
Wide screen elephant.
Say that again?
Wide screen elephant, okay.
What else? Elephant in a jungle. What else? Say that again? Male elephant, okay. Very interesting.
Prehistoric elephant.
Prehistoric elephant, okay.
Forest.
Say that again. So here is the challenge, right? Everybody is looking at the same data. I think of it as a data. Why did we first reaction was elephant? I actually brainwashed you in the very beginning by showing so many elephants. This is how we look at the data. When we ask somebody to look at the data, we have this mindset that give me this answer I am looking for in that data. Right? And so person will go and write an algorithm or write an Excel sheet or create the chart for you. Okay, yeah, sales are going down. That's it. Very good. So this is how we are. We don't go beyond it. First of all, in this picture,
We said elephant because we have been trained to say that, okay, four legs, one tusk, tusk and trunk, that means it has to be elephant. Right? We have been trained from childhood to say that. And that's how we looked at it. But what we did is we used our knowledge. We actually did some action where that means we fire our neural networks inside the brain and we recognized a pattern. But the pattern that we recognized was only based on what we already know. We didn't fire beyond it. So that's where big data and data science comes into play, right? I'll show you some differences in a few seconds. It's not an elephant, it's a picture of a mastodon, which is an extinct animal. Now you'll watch this picture carefully, it will change into this. Here is the elephant, we know. Now, I'm going to show you some outlier things in this picture. This elephant, everybody agrees, this is the elephant we see in modern days, right? If you look at it, this mastodon's ears are very, very small. The whole picture is in one color, pretty much. But if I put at this one, there's different things. Sky is there, the plants are there, the grass is there, right? So one should know the differences when we are looking at things. That becomes very, very important. And this is what we call in machine learning called feature extraction, fancy term for trying to analyze things, right? Firing neural networks and doing pattern recognition. So if I were to look at that picture, the first one I would have said it's a very uniform picture in one color, so it has to be a painting of something that I don't know. But it looks like it has four legs, ears are very small, so it doesn't really fit what I know of an elephant, right? So you have to start looking at data in a different manner, different way. And this is what, as Peter pointed out with the skills that a data scientist has, that's what data scientists do. Same data, look at differently, right? And these are the aspects of big data analytics that help. So how do we actually use in practical life? Give you an example here. So this is a process life cycle, data that comes in. All of us can read this Excel file, right? Now, if we were to actually read this Excel file, there is no way we could make any sense out of it, in which portion of this process was actually congested or people are spending time. But I can actually now convert into some kind of clustering algorithms and actually look at which people are using what function of that process life cycle. Right? I'm just giving you a very high level insight into it, but it totally changes the way that data was there. That data was like this. I just converted into using some algorithms into a very nice way, each of the user for that process and what steps in the process life cycle they are taking. And you can see there are different width of lines that tells you how many people are there at what kind of time they are spending on a certain process event. And if I go further deeper into it, I can take one particular event that is happening during this process life cycle and look at how many people are actually doing the same kind of things. Now, this only totally changes things. Like if this process was, people were supposed to spend only 1 minute on it, but they're spending 30 minutes, we have a problem that we have not actually seen because nobody's recording it. Right? So this is the kind of things that we do to look at the data from historical point of view. Once that is done, then we build real-time model that whenever this event happens, you alarm and send an alarm to the right operator to fix the things. So there is a step-by-step process in this. Analyze the historical data to look for these kind of inefficiencies and then build real-time systems so you can actually fix those inefficiencies in the system. Another example, that we work with, of course, various equipment manufacturers for IoT, right? These are our instruments which collect some kind of metrics. We connect it with some IoT devices in real time, all right? Work with partners and present it in a various fashion, both in the field, whether it's in the cloud or in the field or in the back office on the same platform that I was showing you earlier. The goal for us is to provide the same insights anywhere and everywhere. Not have like back office do something and then you make a call and then do something. That by the time your time is over. So connecting the real-time IoT devices improving that process is very, very important by leveraging these virtualization techniques that we have. With this, I'll summarize it, right? Process lifecycle optimization and value creation is important. One should look at big data in a holistic point of view, right? It's all about creating return on innovation, because the things that you find, the hidden inefficiencies that leads to innovation in either process or equipment or in talent, right? And the only way one can do it is by leveraging the data pipelining method using a single platform approach, and which has to be scalable and adaptable for future. If not, there are disruptive forces that work. These are the real elephants. These are real pictures on the road to a school in India, where elephants can actually create damage when you're problematic. That's all I have. Any Q&A?
Gentlemen, thank you all for agreeing to participate. Maybe starting from Bert, if you wouldn't mind just introducing yourself and just saying a little bit about your background.
Yes, okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Bert. I'm from Europe, from Belgium. A couple of years ago, I stopped my job at Bayer Material Science as a process engineer, and I started Trendminer very young in the early days with respect of data analytics for process data. And today we are with 50 people, international, and trying to change the process analytics.
Thanks, Bert.
Hello. Good afternoon. My name is Subrat Tripathi. I represent L&T Technology Services, one of the gold sponsors of this event. L&T Technology Services is a pure play service engineering service provider globally. And we provide these services with about 10,000 plus engineers that we have operating out of North America, Europe, and India. My personal responsibilities is promoting our business in the industrial product segment in North America.
Robert?
Thanks. Robert Golightly with Aspen Tech. About 35 years in manufacturing, 20 of it in advanced process control and manufacturing execution systems. And I'm currently running the marketing function for our asset performance management suite at Aspen.
Mike Strobel, I'm the product manager for our system performance modeling product at Aspen Tech. Formerly, my company had created this technology 15 years ago, and we've been using it all over the world, and now we're integrating that with a lot of the different Aspen products and looking at more of a holistic system approach.
Dr. Priyadarshi.
All right. I'm the Chief Data Scientist and Technology Fellow at Halliburton. I've been with the company for less than three years, about 15 years in big data space.
Yeah. Thank you, gentlemen. So I just have a question as a panel moderator. I'd like to start with a really tough one. Much of the discussion seems to center on the operational side of the work processes for the process industries. So what I'm wondering about is the ultimately, where do you see is the biggest benefits for the design side? You know, we often think about design processes as very disconnected from the operational side, just with the nature of the way that plants are built today. So, but we see analytics is starting to spread in its use cases across the different processes. Maybe this is just an open question for anybody on the executive panel. If you'd like to offer some answers as to how you see things changing from the design side with analytics.
I can make a quick comment. Benjamin Franklin, or maybe one of his alter egos, like Poor Richard, stated that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And of late, the companies that are a little bit more advanced on the reliability curve are looking at implementing at the design stage, reliability practices and processes. So anything over X million dollars, typically 5 to 10, they say you have to do a reliability analysis for this whole system before we ever build it. Of course, that being said, just like humans, we sometimes don't take the preventive measure. We wait until we have to do the cure. So it's best to do it early, and a lot of companies are starting to do that. But the biggest apple out there is, of course, improving existing systems.
Okay. Any other comments from the panelists?
Well, I guess I'll start first by saying thank you. That's the best big data presentation I've heard. That was just outstanding. And I'm particularly taken with that hidden inefficiencies aspect of your presentation. And I think that's one of the big opportunities as we use machine learning to sort of learn what we know we don't know and find those things on the operational side that are impacting the asset. The ability to feed that back into the design process and make those processes more robust, I think, is one of the brass rings.
Okay, maybe I'll just fire away another question since I've got you all primed. So you're all working with a lot of different customers, and Dr. Priyadarshi, you know, you're involved on the with Halliburton's business. So you're off developing solutions. So there, you know, oftentimes this concept of the data science scientist and the complexity comes up as a barrier. So could you just talk a little bit about that and barriers that you see for adoption in industry? I think that might help everybody understand.
Oh, where do I start? I think the barrier is actually in understanding the value of it. If you think of people who have spent 20, 30 years doing a process in a certain way, they believe that what they know is perfect and they have been optimizing it. This is why industry talks about operational excellence, right? Which itself, by definition, blocks you to a certain level, and beyond that, you don't actually look at it. What I talk about is operations excellence, which is different from operational excellence. Operation excellence is how do I improve on my current operations and increase the value, right? And that thinking is required. That is a very different thinking. That means keep improving your process by looking at more and more. I can give you many examples. It took me about 2.5 years, or roughly 2 years, to actually get Halliburton on board with this program, even though they thought that is important, but to actually make it a full-fledged solution or whatever you want to call it, it took us 2 years because a lot of education is required, showing the hidden inefficiencies in the data that they have stored. And that's when it becomes a business case, right? People, everything we talk about is return on investment, and that's where most of the things fall down. Because there is no way to, just the example that I was showing of a mastodon, most people can't figure that out, right? And that's what we are looking. And they give us the data, they say, give me results in 6 weeks. That's not going to happen because you're looking for things that you don't know. So it's a very iterative process. So education is number one. Education with a very specific goal of showing them one or two examples. And once you have shown them, then they actually get on board. So currently, as I speak, after 2.5 years, we have 34 different projects going on. And if anybody knows about Halliburton, we have 14 business lines in different areas like exploration, drilling, and things like that. Each one of them is actually doing some project related to finding these hidden inefficiencies. The second part is finding talent. That is, as I think I mentioned earlier in the morning as well, in US alone, there's a scarcity of something like 250,000. Pick the number from whichever consulting company you want to pick. But that's the number they say that we lack in terms of data scientists. You can't produce data scientists overnight. We haven't actually, none of the industries have actually invested in it, except for a technology company. I do come from a technology company, right, pre-Google. So AOL, many of you have heard of it. So I built my first data science team in 2000. This is my fourth data science team in my career, right? So companies like technology companies have been ahead of this game because they realize the value of it, right? We all love Amazon, right? We buy a book and they tell you the recommendation engine and we are very happy about it. But we can't build a recommendation engine for our own systems. Today, a mechanical pump fails in whether my industry or any other industry. What do? We go to experts and saying, oh, this happened, tell me what happened. Why can't we build a recommendation engine? Saying these are the five possible causes with this probability. Can you fix it? No, we don't, because we are not actually leveraged the data. Tacit knowledge sits in people's head. And of course, in oil and gas company, as we know, most of those people are retiring. And we have never captured that. Right, so that's the talent is second biggest challenge. The third challenge is actually, you have to coach them on the concept of return of investment versus return of innovation. Because when you are doing things with analytics, it's all about innovation. Because that's how we change the business strategy. Like the example would be the mining company in Australia. They actually invested in it. Today, they can actually mine by sitting in the middle of, like they're sitting on Perth and the other cities and mine in the middle of the, in the desert, right? Completely autonomous. Of course, you know, US military flies planes sitting in Arizona, anywhere in the world. So there are examples that is there, but when it comes to industrial applications, we haven't gone there that far.
I think if I can add to that, Peter, in my role as we meet varieties of customers in the industrial product segment, oil and gas segment, I see the barriers kind of, break into three different categories. One is, the first one is a set of apprehensions. You know, is this for me? Is this something that will make my business more lucrative? Is this, do I have the talent like Dr. Satyam mentioned about? Is it a complex problem for me to solve? Is it going to compromise my data security? So there are a lot of apprehensive questions. And you know, one of the sessions before in this earlier afternoon, we saw some polling being done. 70% of the audience in the room, you know, said that their organizations are at very early stages of either discussing the problem or discussing the solution or trying to do some proof of concepts. So a lot of apprehensions at this stage. And the second one is the cost versus ROI. Is it a monster that I'm dealing with? What will be my tenure of the return on the investment that I'm going to make? So that is another debate that many companies are going through. And most important is the third one, which is the organization culture. If it is a large company and a conglomerate, you know, making those decisions are very, very complex. And also, you know, if you're in a commodity type of product, probably decision making is very easy. But if you're in a technology intensive manufacturing and product line, then it becomes more complex. So I think the OCM part, the organization change management part, is a big barrier in adapting to some of these new concepts and technologies.
Thanks. Any other comments from the panel?
Yes. Bird? I want to add one thing, and very good comments here. There's one thing we see or see from customers coming back all the time, is when you look to an implementation score of any analytics project, you can break it down in two parts. You have the value or the perceived value, but you have also minus the perceived risk. And risk is, for example, something like management of change. And if you want to introduce a lot of new innovation and it changes the way too much how plans operate or people think, like process engineers, it decreasing the value for people. So you have to bear in mind that also you cannot change too much how people work. And we think that's an important factor that a lot of companies forgetting at the moment.
And just a quick comment on that. Mm-hmm. It kind of comes back to what you put up there, and holistic is the key word. You have to look at the whole picture. And all of the great analytics and tools that are looking at individual failures and possible events in your system, that's just a single event. Mm-hmm. But in the holistic system, you've got a buffer tank downstream, you've got a redundant plant, you've got turn-up capacity, you've got seasonal demand, you've got weather issues, you've got people. And unless you can quantify that as a part of the holistic system, bringing in people's capabilities, bringing in the financial, then we're still not there yet, because we're getting smarter on saying, hey, that thing's about to fail, but what does that really mean? Truly to the business. And so holistic thinking, like you showed, is really the last tier where you're able to place that in a context. And another thing that you brought up was about the people, and you mentioned 250,000, whatever the number is, that's gonna be decades away from being viable. So you have to find ways to place the data scientist into the box, put him into the machine, take that knowledge and let the regular Joes out there use it in the existing facilities. So mm-hmm. I think that's the challenge, is moving from very, very interesting science to where the rubber hits the road, and then finally up to the level of making a financial decision.
I like the word regular Joe. But No, but that's true. But there's one thing: the people you call regular Joe, they still need to be trained in getting analytics awareness, because there's still a learning curve on that side, even if they're regular Joes or subject matter experts. So
yeah, when the tide comes in, we all have to be lifted a little bit.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now, what about from the audience? Any questions for the, you'd like to direct at a specific panel member or a general question to any one of the panel members?
Go easy on us, it's late.
Yeah, this is Craig Sutton from John Deere. I'm hearing about a lot of data scientists that are, we got a gap. And then I hear this other emerging technology called artificial intelligence. Just thoughts on whether the AI wave is going to actually engineer us around our data scientist gap that we have?
So AI is nothing new, right? We had AI in 1960s, 1950s actually, right? So it's nothing new. The computing technology enables us to use that technology now, right? The data science, so it's like, analogy I'll give is Excel has been there. All of us have used Excel. I guarantee you that nobody uses more than 5% of the capability of Excel. There are very few people who actually use 100% of all the functionalities, the complex functionality of Excel, right? So similarly, AI algorithms exist, but doesn't mean that you know how to use them. That's where the data scientists come in, right? They know how to interpret that what is coming out of those results. So you can download pretty much open source AI algorithms now, run it against your data, but what will you do after that? That's a challenge. So there's nothing, data scientists are needed to actually explain you what is needed in combination with the domain experts. It's not just that you put a computer scientist, of course my panelist friend said that you can have any Joe run these things. It's not that easy, because you can run any algorithm for that matter. I can give you software now, you can take it and run it. But what happens after that? Are you able to figure out the differences in the patterns? That's more important. It's a visual component, or the interpretation component is very critical part of it. Right? Many of the people who are running a statistical algorithms, they will come and explain your data very nicely with saying, my RMS value is so and so. And after that, they can't relate it to the physical phenomena that we are talking about. So that's where that bridge has to be crossed.
I guess I'd add to that I think that when you look at data scientists as a cultural change agent, that's an important part of the formula. Certainly there are efficiencies in putting the data scientist in the box, but for us to be amenable to what these technologies can do for us, we have to be willing to take those risks and try. And so I think the other role of the data scientist is as a change agent, and that's an important role.
So. Just a comment on, since we're talking about data science technology, and I know there's certainly a lot of old systems, and some of the other tracks here at ARC talk about obsolete systems, and we've got a whole initiative around open automation to deal with Fortran, and engineers today don't really get exposure to Fortran type codes. So I guess my question is from your experience, attracting people to join heavy process or industry, where keeping having it so that they don't go to work for Google or for Facebook, and like, what are your recommendations on building teams or taking chemical engineers and having them become citizen data scientists? Because that's another dimension about people that get good with data, but they don't have to use MapReduce and other technologies that are perhaps behind the scenes, but there's tools that they can still get access to data. So recommendations for attracting people to the industries, what do you recommend? It's an open question to anybody on the panel.
I think you're best equipped to answer that.
Dr. Priyadarsha.
So I have a PhD in chemistry, but never mixed chemicals, but it's all in theoretical or quantum chemistry, or what people would call quantum physics. And just have to play with data for quantum level data, but as a result became a data scientist for modern businesses, right? But my team, I have an atomic physicist who's a PhD in atomic physics. I have a chemical engineering PhD. I have a mechanical engineering. I have a petroleum engineering. I have a geologist. I have a geophysicist. So all combinations of people who have actually played with data for whatever domain they have been are actually become data scientists. How do you attract them? It's a hard question, but I think in my experience, you can't micromanage them. That is one important part I tell everyone. The moment I micromanage a data scientist, he's going to go to Google. Believe me. And this we see every time. In fact, I can tell you, in Houston recently, some big oil companies hired some data scientists, and they gave them a project and saying, I need results in X weeks, right? And the results did not come out in that many weeks because the data was not good or whatever. And they said, oh, you guys don't know what you're doing. The guy actually went and joined one of the Silicon Valley companies and is very happy there. There are a bunch of such examples. The thing is, if you are connecting data sets which you don't know, and then quality of the data, people actually clean the data and give it to them. The moment you clean the data and give it to a data scientist, you already took out features from it. You see? When you take out the features, then how can I tell you when it failed? Because you already removed what you thought was an outlier. But if you gave me the raw data, I will tell you that your outlier has a pattern too. Right? So micromanaging data scientists is one of the bad things. Of course, we are business, right? So you have the leadership who knows exactly when to balance it out. That's very, very important. And that requires even leaders to think in terms of data science terms. So those are also very limited number of such people who are open to such open-ended challenges. But I think if you specify a business problem, saying these are the things we are looking for, give them enough time, ask them to find the right questions so that they can ask the right data, because even to get data in any big organization is one of the biggest challenges, then connecting that data and then building insights, I think they will be very happy, mm-hmm. because that's what they love doing it.
Yeah.
And so I think that's what has worked for me.
I want to make a comment here, and this is more from the vendor side, of course. But what surprises is if you look to the nature of data scientist, the domain is fastly evolving. And so you need to give the guys enough free time. We call it technology spikes or whatever. They can play with new stuff, play around without too much pressure on delivering. And it gives a good outcome because they come with new insights. They learn from other companies. And we foresee that time in each kind of guy's work week, and it pays off a lot. So those guys need the free time to investigate new stuff.
Yeah. Okay, thanks, gentlemen. Sal, is there a question back here?
Okay. Maybe just a comment and perhaps a question. We talk about a lot of the complexity associated with current crop of data science algorithms and software technologies. That's probably just a sign of immaturity, that we haven't matured the field yet as we should, and that there's still work ahead of us. And that eventually you'll probably have to get to a point where the software runs somewhere in the cloud or somewhere in a server farm or whatever it is, and the user isn't really aware of that, don't know, don't care. And the algorithms are there, yes, they're sophisticated. It was built by a small, highly competent data science team, but it's now deployed enterprise-wide, and everybody's getting the benefit of that without knowing any of the complexity. Now, I don't want to know exactly how the engine management system in my car works. I trust that it works because I've tested it on a real road and it did really well. But I appreciate the embeddedness of the technology, the maturity of the technology. And I think this is part of what the journey we have to undertake with analytics, that we get away from like it's fairy dust, because it's not fairy dust, it's engineering and computer science, right? It's just new computer science, new algorithms, or better algorithms. And get to a point where it's an embedded part of the business process, it's an embedded part of the equipment that's made in the factory, that when a distillation column leaves a manufacturer's facility, that it's instrumented. Why do we instrument them in the field? Why are they not standardized? Why don't we have instruments on the trays internally? There's a whole bunch of engineering work that can and should be done to get us to a point where we have richer data and where the fairy dust is just more engineering, more science, that's a standard part of what we do. And, you know, yes, we have innovators that live in a central group that does good work for the company, but their handoff is not, here's an ugly model that you will have to struggle with to ever run again. It gets embedded. It goes everywhere without complexity.
So I agree with you. In the platform that I showed in my slide actually does that for oil and gas industry, especially the upstream side. right? Because they don't, not everybody can build these algorithms because it's very, as I said, even exploration, like you can get 1 square kilometer is 5 petabyte. How many people will get that kind of training set to do it, right? So we build those kind of things and test it out and put them into the platform.
Okay, another question from the audience, please.
Yeah, so let's say as an end user, when you think about trying to get to the predictive or prescriptive type of maintenance, do we really know enough to be able to determine that, or is that really up to like the OEM that has, you know, the amount of that make model we may have may not be statistically significant versus what the OEMs produced. I mean, I'm just trying to say, so as an end user, can we really get to the point where we as an end user can determine what the predictive or prescriptive maintenance is, or do we really need to leverage the OEM to be able to get to that? Because we may not have the innate domain knowledge, or is there enough data in there from this, let's say, from the small sample set that we may have in our facilities to be able to make that determination?
I can make a comment. I was involved in maintenance for a number of years, and I don't know if it's an OEM issue as much as it is the quality of the software that keeps learning. So it's going to learn on what you already have, but it's going to keep learning by asking input from the end user. Is that really a failure? Is that indication really something, an anomaly, for instance? So it's kind of a combination of end user intelligence and then the baked in data science that's already in the tools. But I think it has an opportunity to completely set maintenance on its head. As Peter was saying earlier, 80 some odd percent of the failures are not predictable. I spent 12 years babysitting rotating equipment and looking at the design, the operations, the maintenance, the installation, and I can attest that it's rarely ever the actual piece of equipment that is causing the failure. It's something out there in the ecosystem, and learning all that with the input from the end user and baking that into the data science behind those predictions, I think that combination kind of does away with the condition-based only or schedule-based, or all those are set on its head. It's just purely what is happening in my system in real time right now in the whole ecosystem of that piece of equipment. So I think it's still very important to have that end-user validation to keep getting, to make that prediction keep getting smarter and smarter.
That said, you know, I've watched for 35 years as companies try to enter the software business when they're not in the software business. And it's one thing to take a toolbox and some smart people and create a successful application. It's another thing to make that kind of technology ubiquitous, scalable, maintainable, and all of those other things. So, if your question is more, should I roll my own or go with the vendor approach? As a vendor, of course, I'm going to say go with the vendor. But go in and eyes open that if you choose to go your own route, you should set your expectations for a 5 to 7 year battle until you get to the point that you've really justified your existence.
Any other comments from the panel? No. Another question from the audience? You know, it's getting late in the day. This is an idea that, this is a concept that I had put up on one of my slides, and it's this union of process and operational data and asset data and operator logs and all this information being available, and like what Halliburton has done is to bring this data together. What recommendations are there for adjusting the work processes? Because it seems to be much of maintenance and operations is done in completely separate work processes. Maintenance people understand rotating equipment, or they understand piping, or they understand trays and how they work. And then there's the folks that understand the process. So oftentimes those two don't come together. So what can you talk about any of your experience in bringing organizations together and changing that process? Because I think ultimately, you know, like the gentleman said, it's, you know, shifting to predictive maintenance or proactive operations requires some significant organizational changes.
So in the big data terminology, we call it converting the dark data to smart data, right? So when you have analyzed the data, right? Now when you're going to collect the future data, that becomes even smarter. So your process have improved, right? Because you remove the hidden inefficiencies that you found, right? And that get educated to the people in the field. So that's why I was talking about continuous improvement process, right? And this is where the value comes in. And not only the way you collect the data, the way you report the data, the bits of the data, how they're going, at what speed should you collect, at what frequency should you collect, all those things get modified based on one project at a time. It's not like I can come up with an answer for everything, but as we'll see new and new things, we keep modifying them. That's the only way to do it. So that's why your process gets better and better.
So any other questions from the audience? I'm gonna ask the panelists one last question. We've got one over here.
Hi, I'm Crick Watterson with Falconry. I have a question for all the panel members to perhaps debate. We have quite a variety. We have new technology on analytics on the left. We have well-established technology and process automation and technologists in AspenTech. We have engineering services, and then we have a data science mentality and perspective on a big company. When we think about applying advanced analytics from any one of your perspectives, from a top-down approach or from a bottoms-up approach, if you could describe from your own perspective the steps that you have to take from starting to operational implementation, are they different from each of your perspectives?
I'm not sure. We should figure that out. I think it's like a lot of things. You need first to have some kind of a decisioning framework that sort of points you at the urgent problems, and it's not as straightforward as it might seem. So our point of view on that is that you can take traditional reliability modeling, and there are people that understand that, but if I told you that I was going to improve the reliability of your home air conditioning by 25%, what would that really mean? So I think the ability to blend financial cost information, modeling flows and things in conjunction with reliability analysis gives a pretty good laundry list and priority order of what we have to worry about. Because now I understand where the risks are, and I understand the probabilities of those risks, but I also understand the financial implications of those risks. That lets me set priority. And so rather than it being a solution looking for a problem, you now have financial information to sort of guide you in where the real problems are. And then it boils down to a decision of, there are three things: things we know, things we know we don't know, and things we don't know. And there are technologies appropriate for those. Analytics traditionally is more about the data that I sort of know and understand, whereas I think machine learning goes the other way. It's about things that we don't know, and it's that discovery mechanism. So I think you gain insight from that ordering process that you go through to figure out what your technology roadmap needs to be to address those problems. That's one point of view.
See, from my viewpoint, as I interface with our customers and prospects, I think I was alluding to the organization culture. I think that is the most important thing that we're seeing, you know, a transformation happening, and particularly the companies that are ahead in the game are looking at having a chief digital officer that could, you know, drive those objectives top down. Unless you have a promoter and then those promoters are driving the organization needs from an investor point of view or operational efficiency point of view or your customer's point of view, you would continue to operate in a discrete manner. Your outcome may not be measurable. And that is the transformation that we are seeing in many, many corporations in trying to drive that top down. If that makes sense for you.
So just one last comment just to the panelists before we wrap up for the day. Is there anything that we haven't covered? Is there any recommendations for folks that are considering advanced analytics and other advanced technologies and machine learning? Is there anything that we should really tell them before we wrap up today? Final recommendations.
Mine would be brave. We can stand around and wait for, you know, a ton of success stories to land on our desk that you know, shows that there's potential success out there. There's a lot of emphasis on proof of concepts, which is really more a test of your organization's ability to take a technology than it is of the technology itself. This change is happening, and it's happening faster than many of us ever thought that it would. And so it's not a time for navel-gazing. You know, let's get into this thing. So take some risk, be brave.
Something complementary here is you see in the industry the nature of that they are afraid of failing projects. Mm-hmm. But if you look to what you can learn from startups and scale-ups, it's a concept of failing forward. So fail fast and repeat and do it better next time.
Yeah.
And it should be also integrated in the mindset of the industry, because if you talk about evolution and innovation, you will fail eventually and you have to adapt and sure. learn and do it again.
No one bats a thousand.
Yeah. But the companies that will not leverage big data analytics, I think there will be a disruptive company which will come out very fast and disrupt the whole industry. That is likely to happen pretty much in any space.
Okay, gentlemen, thank you very much. Please join me in thanking the panelists.